The Sportscast, January 28th, 2020. If you haven't yet, please subscribe in all our channels, YouTube, Periscope, iTunes. And if you're on iTunes, please leave a rating and a review. It will help us out tremendously. Super Bowl LIV, LIV, the 54th Super Bowl in the NFL era, actually the 50th in the modern era of the NFL, between the Kansas City Chiefs and the San Francisco 49ers, will play in Miami this weekend. And today we have a big show today. First is we're going to have Victor Arocho coming on in a few minutes, but we got Mr. Justin Riley to start off the show. Justin, welcome back to the Sportscast.
Glad to be here, man, for this big edition of the Sportscast talking about the Super Bowl. I have healed from my team's beatdown from a few weeks ago. I'm good to go now. I'm focused, so let's get it going.
Obviously, you know, like the biggest surprise, I want to say that everyone thought that the Baltimore Ravens were going to go to the Super Bowl, but it turned out to be Kansas City Chiefs. People predicted them to be a favorite earlier in the season, but I guess when Patrick Mahomes got injured, people became skeptical. But are you convinced this Chiefs team is the best team in the AFC?
Well, definitely in the playoffs, they've definitely have taken that next step and have elevated their game. And it looks like they're becoming elite. It looks like they're taking that baton that was once held by the Patriots and are running and may be that next big team that could possibly, you know, win a couple of trophies for the next few years. Now, it's funny is that everybody just had written off, like you said, that the Chiefs, as soon as Mahomes went down, and then the Ravens caught fire, and they probably were the hottest team in the NFL this season, and everybody thought that it was their Super Bowl to lose. And, you know, with good reason, because no one was coming close to beating them. However, come playoff time, it was a different story, and the Miracle Titans were able to take down the presumed champs. And, you know, here's Kansas City, right here where a lot of people predicted them to be at the beginning of the season.
Yeah, something that seeing them, you know, playing against the Titans and the Rocket. I mean, the Rockets, the Houston Texans. You know, they came back. Yeah. Like, they had firepower. Is this the team of the future?
And quite possibly.
Victor Arocho.
Yeah.
Welcome to the Sportscast.
Hi, you're on already?
Yeah, we are live, and I'm trying to get Justin Riley in. Anyways, Justin? Justin? Hello?
Justin's on.
Justin Riley. Are you there? Oh, no. Not this at the end. Hey, guys. I'm having issues with connectivity on my end. You may listen. You might hear fine on your end, but I'm having issues. We might have to record this live. Like, we'll probably have to record this. Yeah, I can't hear you. Hold on, guys. Let me do this again. Sorry about that. Sometimes the Sportscast could get a little bit crazy with the connections. We're talking about the Kansas City Chiefs and the San Francisco 49ers on the Sportscast. Victor Arocho.
Sir.
Welcome back to the Sportscast.
I'm back.
But let me get Justin. If Justin doesn't work, we'll probably have to record this offline.
Do what you want to do, man.
If that's okay with you. Let's give it a shot. Victor Arocho is our NFL correspondent.
Hello.
Justin Riley.
I'm here.
Victor Arocho.
I'm in.
So far, it sounds good. So we'll just start with this. Victor Rocha, what are your thoughts over the Super Bowl?
I don't know how to answer, but...
Hold on. This is bad. Hold on, guys. Let me...
I'd like Andy Reid to win the Super Bowl, though.
How about you, Justin?
Well, this Super Bowl has a different feel. I mean, obviously, because there are no Patriots in sight. It's definitely exciting because, you know, for once we're going to have something new. We're going to have a new team win it all. But someone who's not new to it, like Victor just mentioned, is Andy Reid. And I feel like this is his chance to finally get that Super Bowl, and a Super Bowl that he deserves. And I've been a fan of his ever since he's with the Philadelphia Eagles. And I just hope that now he's finally going to get, you know, that big trophy, that ring, and ascend to or cement his legacy, as I'm trying to say. But, yeah, it's exciting. I wish the Ravens would have been in it, but, you know, we blew it, and quite convincingly.
Because of your boy Derrick Henry.
Yeah, Derrick Henry. Now, hey, I was a little torn there because – I'm a Ravens guy, but I'm also an Alabama guy. And, you know, I loved it for Henry, but, you know, he had to embarrass my Ravens. But if anybody was going to do it, I'd rather have been Henry. I just wish the Titans could have kept on their miracle walk and would have at least gotten to the Super Bowl. But they're not, and the Kansas City Chiefs are there.
You know that I've been hearing rumors that Tom Brady might go to the Tennessee Titans?
Nah, he's going to San Diego, bro. I told, like, remember, I called it several weeks. And remember last year? Don't forget San Diego. Write these things down.
I mean, I personally think it'll be the Chargers. Justin, what do you think?
It's going to be the Chargers. He's not going to go to cold-ass Tennessee.
I actually remember that podcast. I was on it. I jumped in.
That's right.
Of our podcast. And we did have that conversation about the possibility of that happening. You know, him going to the Titans, I don't know where this is coming from, but I mean, it's an interesting thing. You know, it'd be kind of cool to see him go there. And to be honest, that's kind of the missing piece the Titans would need to actually get to the Super Bowl. But I got to agree with Victor. I don't see him going to Tennessee.
Justin Wright, let's back into the Super Bowl here. Victor, do you think the Kansas City Chiefs and Andy Reid have the right weapons to win the Super Bowl?
I think they got the. I just think that they got the right weapons, and Mahomes is just crazy good, man. I mean, when he put up 50 something points and they were down 21, I could not believe it. You know, that guy's a superstar, man. I mean, I think it's going to be close, though. I think San Francisco's a good team. That defense is ferocious.
Justin, what does San Francisco have? What are the advantages they have in the Super Bowl?
Well, you had to start with defense, man. They have one of the nastiest defenses in the league. You know, they've just been just freakish, if you will. And they've made life a living hell for opposing offenses. And that's kind of where it starts with the 49ers. It's that defense. Then, you know, they also are able to control the line of scrimmage on defense and on offense. So they're able to dictate how the flow of a game goes. You know, they're not too flashy offensively. They just have an offense that just wears you down and forces you into submission. And just to make sure you're submitting, you know, Nick Bosa comes off the edge and takes you down. But, they've just been absolutely amazing in that department. You know, they've been able to stifle running games in the playoffs. That they've held teams to 41.5 yards rushing. That's saying something. But the thing is, I don't know if they faced an offense like Kansas City's the entire year. So I think they're going to be facing a real tough challenge this Sunday.
To Justin's point, everything he said, I agree. But the challenge is going to be when you have such a great defensive line like that, I mean, you got to continue, you know, Mahomes thrives off of being chased. You know, like his big plays have come when he was making stuff happen. When he scored that running touchdown, he faked the defensive line guy out. Like, he was going to go out, he was going to go in. So I think that's going to be a problem.
Absolutely. I agree with you there. You know, any problem that defense has had has been with mobile quarterbacks. And who better at being mobile than Mahomes, like you said. I mean, last week, man, it looked like he was coming out of the movie The Matrix, just the way he was able to weave and bob and just fake people out. You know, and I really hope the Tennessee Titans had ankle insurance, because they all got broken last week.
Yeah.
It was just absolutely amazing. I couldn't put into words what I was seeing. Incredible.
He's playing quarterback like a point guard. In other words, you know, when he's doing either no-look passes or he does a fake left and goes right, those are basketball moves. Quarterbacks don't do that. They either run straight for the cone or that's it, you know, or they're going to juke you like Deshaun Watson or Lamar Jackson, right? They just outrun you and speed you. He's literally like, you know how you look off a receiver or you look off for the defense? He's doing that running.
Yeah, something that
is absolutely amazing. You know, he's got like this blue collar mentality too. He's not afraid to take a hit. He's not afraid of being that alpha dog and just taking over in whichever way his team needs. And when he's called upon to run, he's not going to be scared. He's not going to be, you know, a quarterback like you said, that's going to just slide and maybe get a few yards. He's a guy who's going to do his damnedest to get an extra 5, 6, 7, 8, 10 or more yards. And that's what's so amazing about him. And that's why his team just responds so well to him. Man, it's wow. He's just so alpha here lately. And his mentality has completely changed this season from last.
But, Victor, what are the offensive tools that San Francisco has to win this game?
Well, their running game is incredible. They got one of the best tight ends. I mean, think about it. When you, they're just chemistry is good. When you got a tight end, it's like it's Kittle, no?
Correct.
You got a tight end like Kittle who has no problem where he doesn't even get the ball thrown to him and he's blocking the way he is. You got talent. Think about it. You know, what does this guy throw? 9 passes or something and Kittle's not upset with it and they're winning and he's still praising the quarterback. I mean, you know, they got weapons they just haven't used. That's the scary part. Right, I think Garoppolo will do enough what he needs to do to get to the ball to the receivers. When you got Kittle, you got that running back. That guy was he was on the practice squad. Did you know that?
Yeah,
Justin.
Okay. Or he must or was. Yeah,
he was on the practice squad. This guy gave him a chance. Shannon gave him a chance. He'd never forget it. The guy put up 250 yards. God, I love stories like that.
Justin, what offensive tools does San Francisco have?
Well, like he just said, man, that the running backs, you know, Raheem Mostert is having one of the best historic stories in history. But also with that comes arguably one of the best offensive lines in the NFL right now. But what's really great is they have all these weapons, and they're all so unselfish. They could care less about getting touches, about getting highlight reel moments. They're more concerned about getting the job done. And man, that's a lost art these days. And a team to have that, it definitely gives them an edge over a lot of people. But you know, their wide receivers aren't too bad either. When called upon, they have Emmanuel Sanders, Debo Samuel, and Marquise Goodwin. You know, they're pretty dang good.
Yeah.
But what's really great about them, and I go back to what I just said, this is a team. This isn't, you know, just an individual. This is a team working together, getting the job done.
Yeah. And you know what makes their offensive line so good, too? Is playing every day against that defensive line.
Oh, no doubt.
You got to get good because those guys will eat you up. Didn't the Baltimore Ravens crush the San Francisco 49ers?
Oh, yeah. It did.
Okay.
It did.
Well, what kind of quarterback does Baltimore have?
Ooh, running mobile quarterback.
Mobile quarterback.
See what I'm saying? I'm just saying to you that it's dangerous, right? Because when you got an extra runner back there, one, it's difficult on defense. Don't get me wrong. They can still pull it off. It's not that they can't. I'm not saying that that's guaranteed. But one, you know, it's hard to contain all the time. And two, it tires out the defensive line because you're chasing the guy. Even if you get him, you're chasing. Does that make sense?
Well, absolutely.
So, I mean, and you know, that's, again, I'm going to you, like, we were talking about the quarterbacks, and Justin said mobile. I mean, Baltimore crushed them.
So, and you're saying foolish. Kansas City will win this game?
I'm picking Kansas City only because, to be honest with you, I just think Mahomes is on he's on a path that is incredible. One, two, I want Andy Reid to win one, and three, I think these guys want to win it for Reid because, you know, hopefully they're smart enough to realize how long Reid has been coaching and he only been to one Super Bowl, that these guys understand it's not easy to go back. You're not the Patriots, you know what I mean? Until you prove you're the Patriots, you're not the Patriots.
There will be no team like the Patriots.
Yeah, you know, I don't know. I mean, nobody thought the Patriots would be the Patriots, but you know, you'll see, right? And it's just a different ball game. But again, you know, it's not easy to make it to the Super Bowl.
Justin, will this game be coming down to tight ends?
It's going to come down to really, you know, who makes the fewest mistakes. You know, who's able to control the line of scrimmage. Who's able to, you know, control the game? Which team is going to take the other team out of its element? It just really could go back and forth. But to be honest with you, I think in order for the 49ers to be able to stay close in this game is they're going to have to put up some points against this high-powered Kansas City offense. And I don't know if they can.
And you got to be worried about, you can't even jump out in front of Kansas City. I mean, they were down 21 points with no problem.
That's so the thing.
Their belief in coming back is already instilled in them. You understand?
But, Victor, can the Niners go ahead like 24-0 and hold that lead? Or you think Kansas City can overcome it easily again?
You know, they've proven that they can. So it's just, I don't know if it's that they put on a different game or whatever it is. They proved that they can do it. Now, the only thing that would sustain, the only difference is if you have a team like San Francisco that jumps out to that lead, their running game is good enough to now slow you down. Because the way to win this game is going to be won by backs. It's going to be running backs and quarterbacks. That's it, right, in my opinion. Number one. Number, you need to keep Mahomes off the field as much as possible.
Which Tennessee couldn't, I mean, they did early on, but they were not able to do it.
They couldn't do it after they went away from their game plan. That was just dumb coaching.
They were on the way.
Absolutely.
Game plan, and then every time you kept giving the ball back to Mahomes. He, you know, not only did he put up points, he put up points in a short period of time. And the only way you can put up points in a short period of time in football is because your offense keeps giving it up. Think about it. Football's not a sport. You go up and down. You got to give up the ball to get somebody else to score, unless you score in defense.
Justin, if San Francisco goes up 27-0, can they hold that lead against the Chiefs?
Oh, hell.
Man, you got to kind of – never one, don't ever count out the Chiefs just based on the resume and what we've seen. But two, you also got to ask yourself the question – you know, how many times can they pull that out? You know, out of their hat. You know, at some point, their luck will have to run out. But as long as Mahomes is given time to do anything, they have a chance. And that's what people's problem have been. They made the mistake of giving Mahomes time to do things. And Mahomes doesn't need a whole lot of time at all, as proven. I mean, he can score 3 touchdowns in 2 minutes. So, you know, if they're able to keep the ball out of Mahomes' hands, then, yeah, if they get a big lead, yeah, they have a chance to pull it out. But they better be prepared, you know, for those dogs to come barking back at them and attacking them, because they're a team that's not going to go away.
Also, it depends on the time, right? Because when a team jumped out on them, they jumped out on them, like, early in the
first quarter. They were up 24-0, the Texans.
Right. So the problem is now you still give this guy three quarters to come back at you.
Plenty of time.
Right? And that's a lot of time. And if you don't control the line of scrimmage, you don't control the – you're going to have a problem. And because Spagnuolo's going to come back. I mean, you know, he's going to come back. He's a good defensive coordinator, dude.
Victor, who
he adjusts. I mean, so two things. You got two things that happened. Mahomes came back, and the defense responded, right?
Correct. Victor? Justin? Yes. Okay.
You were going to ask a question.
You left. Okay, so, okay, back in, like, because I really think it's going to come down to tight ends. Which tight end is the most important for each respective team? Is it Kittle's or will it be Kelsey? Who is more important for this game?
Well, they're both equally important. But the thing is, though, with Kansas City, they don't have to just rely on Kelsey. You know, they've got, you know, they still have, you know, Sammy Watkins who can come alive at any moment, Mecole Hardman, and then they also have Tyreek Hill.
Who will guard Tyreek Hill, Victor?
I don't know, man. The defensive line.
Justin?
The defensive line. You understand why I said defensive line?
What was that?
Sandale, you know why I said the defensive line?
Yeah, why? I'm kind of confused.
Okay. Because the defensive line has to cut down the seconds the quarterback has back then. It's the only way to stop Tariq. You can't give that speed guy time.
You can't.
Even a 40-yard dash takes 4 seconds to run, right?
Right.
And when that is without anybody hitting you, you start giving that quarterback longer than 4 seconds, he's going to eat you up. That pressure has to – the only way to stop a fast receiver is getting pressure on the quarterback.
Justin, how can you stop Tyreek Hill? What would you do for the Niners?
Well, I gotta agree with Victor, you know, but also too, they just can't, you know, they can't allow time. They can't allow him to get separation. They can't allow the plays to get set up. They're gonna have to be very disruptive. Of course, I'm assuming that Richard Sherman will probably be on him too, so that makes a big difference there. But the biggest way to stop Tariq Hill is disrupting his routes and disrupting the timing.
Yep. You got to hit him.
Got to hit him
the thing
hard.
Is, you can't keep up. Yeah. You got to hit him. He's small. You got to hit him and hit him and hit him and hit him and hit him. And the thing is, he's so fast and tiny, no one's ever got a clean hit on him.
Richard Sherman, how much of an importance is he, Justin?
Oh, I mean, he's probably the most important in that secondary. You know, he's the veteran leader. He's the guy who already has Super Bowl under his belt. He's a multi-time Pro Bowl participant. He's arguably the best defensive back in the game right now and one of the best ever. So he's absolutely huge. You know, he dictates how that defense is going to go. So, and they're going to need every bit of him, you know, to be present in this game.
Victor, Richard Sherman, what does he mean to you?
Man, he's a baller. I mean, he's a, when you're a defensive back and you're a veteran and as good as him, the thing that makes defensive backs that great is they, like a batter can see a baseball in the seams, a great defensive back understands the route that's being ran. And that's what makes him so great. Like, he understands what you're going to do. Think about the last interception he had. He saw what that guy was doing. He ran to the ball. He didn't care about the receiver. He knew what the play was going to be. So, you know, his Super Bowl experience, his ability to deal with adversity, his ability to have a short memory. You know, he got beaten and came back and got a pick. You know, he brings that pedigree to that locker room. He's going to be big. Now, he hasn't got the speed like he had, and he's not going to have the speed for Tariq Hill, but he's going to be a critical component just on experience and his ability to already have a Super Bowl. And I guarantee you, he's talking to those guys and telling them, you're not going to be here all the time, because he should have won the second Super Bowl if they didn't call that dumbass play against the Patriots.
One person we have not talked about much is Jimmy Garoppolo. Justin, what does Jimmy Garoppolo mean to you?
Well, I mean, he's had a fantastic season, and it's been great seeing him finally get the success. A lot of people really were anticipating him to have. Just unfortunately, you know, he's had to battle, you know, some horrific injuries. But this has been his first full season being the man and being able to just, I guess, unleash. And but the thing is with him, he does well when that running game is doing well. When the offense is able to be balanced, you know, if they're able to run the ball, control the line of scrimmage, and then he's able to do his thing. Things are able to open up. He's able to do more. Now, the only thing I'm concerned about is what happens when the ball or the game is placed in his hands to win. Will he be able to do it?
Victor, what is Jimmy Garoppolo? What can he do for this game?
Well, again, he's got good receivers, and he's got guys that are going to rally around him. So I think, you know, again, the challenge about doing what he was doing, and you saw the same thing with Tannehill, is, you know, if a guy's not given enough runs, it's great and dandy to win a game and only throwing the ball 9 times, and if that gets you a double, it's fine. But you're not getting any reps with your receivers in live game experience, you understand? So, you know, timing in practice is one thing. Timing in a game that's live is a different ball game. So absolutely. I think that the game can't come down to Jimmy against Patrick Mahomes. Jimmy's going to lose that one. Mm-hmm. Right? So I think he can perform. I think he'll get there. Everyone doubted him, and I didn't, right? Not that I was putting him up, but I didn't go against him either. It's just from what I've seen in the game, I don't think that game experience and speed is totally different than practice speed.
Justin?
The guy on the other side of the ball really wants to kill you.
Oh, absolutely, man. I mean, you know, you can only get away with, you know, doing things like he did in this past game. And then what Ryan Tannehill did in the past couple of games before the AFC Championship for so long, there's going to come a time to where, you know, you're going to have to do more. You're going to have to produce more. And like Victor is saying, if you don't have those reps, if you're not going to your receiver and getting that timing established, getting that chemistry established, it's going to come back to haunt you, especially if the game comes down to, you know, Jimmy G having to pass his way to a victory. You know,
the Super Bowl ain't the time to try to get your timing on.
No, you can't make it. You can't make up for lost time in the Super Bowl. Yeah.
That's the wrong time to try to get practices.
Let's do our concluding predictions.
Nah, we can't get off this phone without talking about 24, number 8, baby.
Yes. Now. Okay.
I
was going to plan to do it after the predictions, but we could do it beforehand.
The prediction. I'm just saying you can't have a sports show without talking about the most devastating on my birthday. I'll never forget it.
Okay. So we'll start with Victor. With your final predictions.
Justin was going to say something. What's up, Justin?
Well, I was going to say before, you know, we get into all that, there's one thing that we have to kind of pay attention to. You know, the Chiefs can score pretty much at will at any given moment. And, you know, their offense has been looking great. But there's one thing about the offense a lot of people haven't really been talking about. You know, when they get into the red zone, they actually struggle a little bit. They've actually scored a touchdown on just 54% of their trips inside the opponent's 20.
But you know why, right?
Why?
Because they're big. It's less field. He can do little. It's you know what I mean. The bigger the field, the easier it is for like offense like that to score. You understand?
Absolutely.
It's tight, right? They don't have the space. You don't have the space. I mean, you're inside the 20. You only got 30 yards. Think about all the play. All the comebacks they had were massive plays. What was his run for? 40-something yards? Think about it. Right? So like that, they need length, right? That's why they have to score outside the red zone. Where San Francisco, inside the red zone, they're tough.
There's some pros and cons for both teams. Victor Rocho, what is your final prediction of the Super Bowl? Give us a score and everything.
I think it's going to be 28-24 Kansas City.
Justin Riley.
Well, I'm going with Kansas City as well. And oof. I think a lot of it has to do – I want Andy Reid to get his Super Bowl. I want his legacy cemented. It's time for Andy to put that on his resume. I'm going to go with the Chiefs, 35-31.
35-31, Chiefs.
So we're both giving a four-point spread.
Even though Victor said that San Francisco had a better defense. But no, yeah, you're right, because Baltimore did beat the Niners. And you could say Ravens and the Chiefs are similar teams, aren't they?
At San Francisco.
Wasn't it at Baltimore? I believe it was in Baltimore.
I thought it was at San Francisco. No,
it was in San Francisco. Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Well, that's huge.
They went to their house and blew them up.
Well, obviously, this week and starting on Sunday, the death of Kobe Bryant he died in a helicopter accident. And the whole world was shocked, not just the sports world. His daughter also died with also a crew of 12 other people in the plane. Let's start with Justin. Kobe Bryant, what does he mean to you, and also what is the biggest memory that you've had about him?
Well, first of all, when it happened, I just was in just a surreal state of mind. I was looking up at the TV screen. You know, I thought they
the sportscast broke the story too. By the way,
yes, we did. I just wish that it wouldn't have been something. I wish it would have been on something more cheerful. I remember looking up the screen, and I thought they were putting a little timeline under Kobe's face because his record was beaten by LeBron James. But then I kept watching it, and then you know the analysts have tears streaming down their face, they're crying, and they say he died. And literally, it's like the world, the universe, just got put on pause. And, you know, everybody collectively in the room that I was at, it's like life had just been taken away from them, you know. And we couldn't believe what we were hearing. I still can't believe what we were hearing. And it just, just broke my heart. Of course, not to level of which his family and the family of those who were lost, have. But good grief. I mean, to me, I've been a Lakers fan for a long time, and I'm not one of those Lakers fans who jumped on the bandwagon as soon as LeBron came to L.A. I've been a fan for a long time, and a lot of that had to do because of Shaquille O'Neal. But then when Kobe came along, it just, it changed the game. And Kobe was the NBA's equivalent of a Michael Jordan. He was the one who took, the reins from Michael and carried it into that next generation. And there is no one, and I can't really just narrow down, what he did to a certain instance, because there were just so many of them. He was just, what I remember the most about him is he was just a fierce competitor. No one was going to outwork him. No one was going to outplay him. He was just an intense competitor. And he was going to do whatever it took to win. And he was as he grew older, he became an incredible mentor, incredible leader. And he's one of those guys who there are very few out there, like a Jordan, who are great, but they're also great because they made others around them great. and Kobe was making other people around him great, and was able to continue to win championships even when Shaquille O'Neal had left for the Heat at that time. Man, he just changed the face of the NBA, you know, and everybody keeps bringing up, you know, this discussion of, you know, anytime you were throwing a piece of paper into the trash or throwing something away, you yell out Kobe and you tossed it. They'll pretend to be Kobe Bryant. You know, that's who everybody wanted to be. If you stepped foot on the court, you know, you were wearing a number 8 jersey, or you were pretending to be him. Man, he just affected so many lives. I could go on and on, but, you know, I want to give Victor his time, but just, man, just blown away by this.
Victor?
Yeah, I was, you know, Sunday was my birthday. Wow. And so I'll never, you know, I'll always remember it. And, you know, because his anniversary is going to be on my birthday, right? So it'll be coming up. I wasn't even watching the regular TV. I was watching Netflix, and my wife was coming back home. We were going to go out to eat and watch a movie. And she goes, man, it's so sad about Kobe Bryant. I go, what are you talking about? She goes, you didn't hear? I go, no, what are you talking about? She goes, yeah, he died. I go, no, get the hell. In other words, disbelief. I couldn't imagine. I mean, even now, I mean, it breaks my heart. You start looking up. At first, they said it was him and all 4 of his daughters, like all the reports that were coming out. I mean, I couldn't imagine. It's bad enough, you know, Kobe leaving, but if his kids and, you know, me being a father, I mean, on Monday, I called my son and called him up and apologized for whatever I did. I mean, I was almost crying.
Wow.
My wife, he was like, Dad, it's okay. What's going on? My wife's like, what's wrong? It's just, you know, it hit me, you know. I'm like, I called my son because, you know, it's a little hard on my son than my daughter, you know, in playing sports as a coach, you know, and I started reeling back when times I scared him. I'm just like, you know, I'm sorry. And just, you know, I'm going to be, you know, direct as I can. You know, I didn't like Kobe in his early years. And okay. I say early years, I didn't like him until maybe 5 years, maybe 6 years late before he retired. And I still thought it was like Jordan. I didn't like Jordan either. So, you know, you listeners that are listening now, it's like, as I got older, you started realizing you need to appreciate greatness no matter what. I mean, if they're not on your team, you don't need to necessarily like them. But, you know, now I don't take for granted. You know, when I see somebody, that's why I don't like when people gamble on sports. I don't like it because then I can't enjoy the game. You know what I mean? Mm. You kind of like, you know, yeah. I don't want to, if someone's betting on a game, I don't want to make it like you're going to lose, but then you're not making me enjoy the game. I don't really give a shit, you know, but I was devastated. But I could tell you this though. I always called him an assassin. And then I wish they would tell the stories, or you would hear more of the stories while players are playing, because, you know, the fans that are, you know, it's like not liking a Boston fan as a Yankee fan, you can appreciate them even more. I learned to appreciate ball players now a lot better than I did before, because in your lifetime, you're never going to know, right? Even Brady, I had to stay up till his last game. And, Kobe, I saw his last game. But the deal is that when you hear stories about his work ethic and what the Mamba mentality was, and, you know, I thought it was all marketing stuff, but you start hearing about what he did in the Olympics and just that kind of, you may not like the guy, but you can't, nothing but ultimate respect. I had respect for his game and Jordan too. I was a big Knicks fan. So, but you just got to really appreciate God given talent like that when it comes across you. And the one thing that I learned about that, you know, the motivation I've gotten from listening to the Kobe stuff, and it still breaks my heart, is he did not care about liking you liking him. It wasn't about that. He didn't talk too much to the opposing players. Even when he went to the Olympic team, they all knew each other, but he didn't really have a relationship with any of them. Wade, none of them. Did you know that?
No.
And so he just played the game. Yeah, he did not care. He wasn't there to make a friendship. He said later on he changed a little bit, but he was there to play the best he could every single day.
He was there to compete, and like he outworked everyone. I mean, he would stay after after a game and practice some more. Even practice itself, he will stay even longer. And even at 31 years old, like you would think he's that kid who's trying to make a team. No, some people say he had harder work ethic, a better work ethic than Michael Jordan.
Nah.
Well, that's up to debate, right, Justin?
Nah.
Well, yeah, it's up for debate. I think they were both equally fierce when it came to work ethic and competing and perfecting their craft and winning. And, you know, just to piggyback on what Victor's saying, you know, in the Olympics, man, he took winning the gold personally. You know, he took it upon himself like
the Redeem team.
He took it personally that, you know, when they lost, and he wanted to be the ambassador representing the U.S. and he was going to get that gold medal come hell or high water. And that's that's all he cared about, man. And it's like, not only was his play causing the victory to come, but his intense will and passion were bringing the victories. And it was spreading to everybody on the court. You know, even like Victor said, even if they didn't have close bonds and relationships, man, that stuff spread to each of the players. And it filtered into their way of playing and their mentality.
Yeah, something that I would definitely, you know, say that, you know, he made his other teammates better. Very similar to Michael. And he will be missed. You know, he died at 41 and it kind of reminds me of some famous people out there, just like Elvis or Steve Jobs, where they had a huge legacy but also had a short life. I kind of correlate with those type of guys, type of people. But, you know, will Kobe be one of the greatest among Michael Jordan and Dr. J? That's a debate we can have.
Absolutely.
I think he gets gets magnified more when they die earlier.
Yeah, correct.
Because you – And it's not saying that he didn't deserve it or anything. It's just that his greatness gets magnified because now everyone knows it. You understand? Like, Justin's a Laker fan, and, you know, I'm a fan, so I'm going to know a lot. And I'm into sports, but I can tell you I know a lot more right now than I did 3 days ago. See what I'm saying?
What he did, what he did, too, you know, it transcends basketball. You know, even if you're not a fan of sports, you know, you don't care about basketball, you go up to any person on the street on any country, any state, whatever. You talk about the name Kobe Bryant. They know who you're talking about. You know, like Ali and Bobby.
You don't even have to say Bryant.
Yeah, no, yeah, he's up there with Michael. Everyone knows Michael Jordan's name. And I can safely say Kobe.
Say Kobe.
you know how his dad came up? I mean, why he named Kobe Kobe? Because I think they were at a restaurant, and I think it was called Kobe Restaurant. And like, I think he just think, hey, let's call our child Kobe. Boom.
Kobe beef too.
Which I heard he was working on to reconcile with his father.
The Olympics? Yeah, well. That's the sad part right there.
I did not know they had a bad relationship.
And having that whole knowing and not knowing this. No parent wants to bury a child.
No,
much
man.
Less being estranged from them, you know?
Yeah. Wow.
So, I mean, it was just terrible. And real quick, the story of the Olympics was, he's got so many stories, but one thing I did hear he'd say that was phenomenal was like, you know, you could play for the Lakers because you don't realize that you can play for the Lakers. You can play for the Heat, the Mavericks, Celtics. When you play the Olympics, you're representing your country. He goes, that's a totally different ball game. You know what I mean? He goes, now he felt like he truly got a chance to serve his country, you know, not from a military perspective, but from an athletic Olympic perspective. And I thought that was pretty powerful for me. You put that USA jersey, he said he felt the difference.
Justin, what is your favorite moment from Kobe Bryant? It could be a play. It could be a moment. It could be a game. It could be whatever. What is your favorite moment from Kobe Bryant?
Man, I can't, like I said earlier, I can't just, you know, narrow it down to one because, there are just so many moments. You know, the biggest thing to me is, you know, is him as a competitor and him making everybody around him great and better and just being that, being who he was for the game, you know, ambassador of the game, ambassador of the U.S. for, you know, the Olympics, you know, guiding the Lakers to, you know, several championships and just doing everything he could as a role model, as a father, that he could, and just being the best at every arena and dedicating his life to being the best in every arena. You know, you can't put Kobe in a box, you know.
No, yeah, Kobe has several memorable moments, like the alley-oop, another good moment. Him, you know, winning the championship against the Celtics. But yeah, Justin, close it out with your favorite memory.
One of the things that kind of disturbed me, you know, and it's a discredit to his memory, was just how many inaccurate reports were coming out from several media outlets, you know, not really knowing the full story, reporting things. Like Victor said, people were reporting that all of his children died, and then saying Rick Fox died along with them, and nobody really had anything accurate. You know, it's crazy. And then you have several people coming out of the woodwork, bringing up the negatives of his past, and some of those were major media outlets talking about it. And it just, you know, regardless of what you think about the man, or regardless of whether you liked him, you didn't like him, you know, respect his family enough to just give them their time to grieve, and don't bring up these horrible things that they ultimately going to hear, they're going to see. Man, these families that are involved have been devastated beyond belief, and the last thing they need to see and hear are media and people talking about things that don't need to be talked about.
Yeah, I know. His past is brought up. Well, anyways, guys, due to time, I got to go and pay some bills. Victor, you got to close the show. Any closing words from Kobe? Anything else? Really quick, 30 seconds.
A prayer for him and his family, and, you know, right. He's going to be missed, and God bless everybody that, you know, that's been affected by this tragic news.
Yes, worldwide, and I know there's been a discussion and a petition signed to change the NBA logo for Kobe, which it's going to be tough because we'll see what the NBA does.
Well, the guy over 1.5 million votes for it so far, so people are taking it seriously.
I would prefer Michael Jordan's logo, but probably I don't think Nike wants that either. So, Victor, what is the best way to reach you to talk to you about Kareem Abdul-Jabbar?
They could, you know, go Twitter at V Arocho. That's V. Like Victor, A-R-O-C-H-O.
And Justin, how can people reach you to talk to you about Jalen Hurts' performance at the Senior Bowl?
Well, I thought you were going to, you know, follow up with another Laker basketball player. I was hoping you'd say Robert Horry.
Or maybe Hurts. Dennis Rodman. He was a Laker for 4 months.
Yeah, he was like there for 2 days, and he couldn't act right. He was booted.
That guy's still alive. I can't believe it.
Who's yeah, that? I know. Yeah, Dennis Rodman. but anyway, to stick with the point, you can reach me on Twitter at Justin Riley 7. That's number 7. You can also reach me a lot of the times because I run the Sportscast Twitter and Instagram. That's at the Sportscast 1. So you can use any of those outlets, and I'll be available to talk to you about anything that Santiago randomly comes up with.
Exactly. And random question, what is your favorite Super Bowl snack item, Victor?
My favorite Super Bowl snack item.
Or food item. Let's just say food item.
You know, the Doritos with the cheese, whatever, the Tostitos with the cheese dip.
Yeah,
you said something. Snack item, right? Or buffalo wings.
That's good, too. Justin?
Yeah, man, buffalo wings, hot wings, brother. Got to have those.
And then for food, Italian sausage with marinara sauce.
Oh, man.
Oh, there we go. I'm coming to Victor's house.
On Publix French bread.
Well, yes. Justin doesn't know what Justin knows what Publix is because he because he used to live in Birmingham.
Did you forget that we did you forget that we lived in Birmingham?
They have a Publix there. But it's different though. So it's a different
the bread
type.
From hey, the bread from Piggly Wiggly.
That's right.
My favorite food item comes down to pizza. Pizza is the safest food item when you go to a Super Bowl party, so
there's no pizza in South Florida. Don't disrespect the North.
Anyways, you can, once again, you can reach us at thesportscast.net, thesportscast.net with the latest and greatest. Catch any news on recruiting, a lot of these new college players going into the NFL draft, a lot going on in the next few months, so we're leading up to the NFL draft. Also, follow us for the NBA. The NBA season is starting to kick in. And then college basketball. You'll be seeing us live tweeting some college basketball games throughout the days and weekends. So it should be pretty exciting. And that, you can follow us at actually on Twitter, at TheSportsCast1. And a lot of things going on in sports. Super Bowl is this week, and everything paralyzes a little bit for Sunday. Anyways, guys, I appreciate you guys coming on to The Sportscast.
Hey, Justin, good to hear from you again.
Glad to be here.
All right, man.